National Education Policy 2020, which was just launched last year, I would try to touch upon each and every facet of National Education Policy because it is after a long gap this new education policy could come. Last education policy was unveiled in 1986. You can see a lot of gap is there. Almost 34 odd years have been passed. And everybody is eager to know and curious to know about the facets of this national education policy, major reforms which they have planned, the thought process which they had, the team which had a Herculean task of making this policy and giving it to the nation. People are even eager to know where they shall be affected, how they shall be affected, what new shall come, which will be even encouraging one, but it would be challenging one also. So basically we are witnessing lot of changes in technology, and with the rise of this technological advances in big data, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science, so and so forth, you could see that a lot of colleges are opting for these branches in their institutions, which we were not knowing earlier, are taking away many unskilled jobs worldwide. They are taking away many unskilled jobs. And it is being replaced by machines. And hence, machine learning is becoming more and more popular. And hence, there is a need for a skilled workforce. And particularly, this skilled workforce must have the knowledge about mathematics, computer science, data analytics, along with their basic knowledge of the social science or other fields. Now, a lot of changes we are witnessing in climate also. Due to large development, we are witnessing the change in the climate also. We are witnessing that population pollution is increasing. Natural resources are decreasing day by day. And we have to meet the energy requirement. And for this, again, we shall be needing skilled workforce, which will have the knowledge in biology, chemistry, agriculture, climate science, and social science. Then we are already witnessing this pandemic. Already witnessing we are pandemic situation. And due to this pandemic situation, we are online, right? So the growing emergence of this epidemics and pandemic is also basically shall trigger the collaborative research in this disease management. And we could see a lot of development took place, and we are proud to say that we have developed even vaccine, right? And so many social issues are coming up due to this lockdown and so many other problems. Then there shall be growing demand for this humanities and arts, basically, as India is moving into the circle of developed country. And also, it will become a part of top three economies. That is a dream of our country, and it will be possible with the proper implementation of this national education policy and their reforms. Now, you could see that there is a changing employment landscape also. Like a technological landscape is changing, Even employment landscape is also changing, and the global ecosystem is also changing. Now, it is very, very important that our children not only learn, but more important is that they should learn how to learn. That is very important. Learn how to learn. Means because at some point of time, whatever they learn today will become obsolete in some time. But they should develop the ability to learn how to learn in future. That is very important on their own. Education must see that the content has to be reduced. But more importantly, we should focus on that they should develop their critical thinking, ability to solve problems. They should be able to work in multidisciplinary domain. They have to be innovative. They should get adapted to many challenging situations which are not there in their hand. And this will require to evolve our pedagogy. Pedagogy is very important to impart education. So pedagogy must evolve, and it should evolve, and it should focus on more experiential learning, holistic development of the children. And it should be learner-centric. It should be learner-centric, right? So that should be our focus. And due to this, your curriculum must include these basic arts, crafts, humanities, sports, languages, literature, right? And this will groom the student well round. Like we say that the student should have the all round personality. So that will be possible with this. And more importantly, education must build the character. Education must build the character, right? And they should enable learners to be more ethical. Ethics is very, very important, right? They should be caring in nature, right? And at the same time, they should be prepared for their employment, gainful employment, right? Because that is the dream of each child. Right? Due to this, there is a gap. There is a gap between the current state of learning outcomes and what is required. And that must be bridged. That must be bridged through major reforms. Right? And these major reforms were considered in the current National Education Policy of 2020. And that to bring the highest quality, equity, and integrity into the system from early childhood. Early childhood care and education. Earlier, it was not focusing from that age. It was focusing from grade one, right? But they have now included the preschool and even that Anganwadi, what we popularly say, where children were used to play and learn. And there has to be the access to the education, highest quality education to all, in spite of their social or economic background. They should be supported for this highest quality education, right? So basically, our Indian knowledge has a rich heritage. And earlier also our gurus, not only this means our spiritual gurus, our parents used to say that we must strive hard to pursue jnana, that is knowledge, pragya, wisdom, and truth. Satya. And that was considered to be the Indian thought and philosophy. And that should be the highest human goal. That should be the highest human goal. And hence the aim of education in ancient India was not just the acquisition of knowledge, which is required for preparation or how to lead this life in this world, and but what come for complete realization and liberation of oneself, which was earlier being thought of like na, like it was just a spiritual thought process, but no, it has to be inculcated basically, right? So now this world-class institutions of our ancient India, you could see that they have set the high standards of multidisciplinary teaching and research. And they have even taught scholars from different backgrounds across countries. Means earlier people used to come to India and teach education. And this Indian education system has produced great, great scholars. Even Aryabhatta, Chanakya were among Gautama. And these scholars basically has made phenomenal contributions. They have made phenomenal contributions in the field of anything you take it, either mathematics, astronomy, yoga, fine art, chess. They have made extraordinary contribution in this field. And you could see that teacher was the center of all these fundamental reforms. Teacher has to be it is the noblest profession of our society, most respectable professions of our society, right? So teacher is at the center of the fundamental reforms in the education system, right? And this new education policy has helped at all levels. And basically, they are helping to reestablish teachers at all levels. Because in recent times, that has lost, the glory of that profession has lost due to some or the other reason. Because teachers, they truly shape our generation. Next generation of citizens is shaped by teachers. Teacher is the only generic profession who teaches to all, not only one profession, but any profession you take it, teacher teaches to them. And hence this NEP must do everything to empower teachers and help them to do their jobs effectively as possible, right? And hence this new education policy is helping to recruit best, brightest, and those who are interested basically to come into the teaching profession, we should be able to select them. But at the same time, we should ensure that they would get the livelihood, proper livelihood, earning, respect, dignity, and more important is autonomy. Autonomy to have its own proper curriculum, pedagogy. But definitely all these, along with this, you should have the effective control also. Not that all you will see that everybody will look for from the same point of view, but you should have the mechanism also for the quality control and accountability, right? So that is possible. And everybody imagines that good institution, good education institution, a holy place, sacred place. Everybody says that. Yeah. So it is the place where every student feels like he's welcomed, cared, they are safe. They get the stimulating and encouraging learning environment. And a lot of learning experiences are offered to them so that they also try to replicate. They learn from those experiences. And for that, you should also provide physical infrastructure, proper infrastructure, which is necessary for good learning. And that should be available. And basically, the goal of every education institution is to achieve all these qualities. But at the same time, they should have the integration and coordination across all the institutions. Not only, see, if you are in a higher education institution, it doesn't mean that you should not have the integration with the schooling. In schooling also, not only the preschooling or the middle school or the high school or the secondary school or whatnot. Across all stages of education, you should have the basically integration. That is very important. And there are fundamental principles on the basis of which the focus of these principles was reflected in this National Education Policy 2020. So few fundamental principles we must know. What was the thought process? See, each student, see, you have to recognize, identify, and foster the growth of each student. Right? Each student has to be taken care. Like a parent, the parent take care of the child. Then the highest priority has to be that foundational literacy and numeracy. See, they should be able to get that by grade 3 so that they lead the life. They are not fooled by anybody when they go to the shop or they do some purchasing or something like that. Flexibility. Learners should be given the ability to choose their learning trajectories. And they should be able to choose their path, right? And there should not be any hard separations between arts and sciences like we have today, curricular or extracurricular, or between vocational and academic streams, because they have the harmful effects and they leave. Because people, they try to live the life alone. Like, I am a science student. He's an art student. He's the social science student. He's the humanities student. So they should not make the compartment. They should not make the compartment, basically. Right? Multidisciplinary and holistic education has to be given priority. Even the sports. Sports has to be given so that they have the integrity. Unity, they learn through the sports basically, and more emphasis has to be given on conceptual understanding rather than mugging up. You are mugging up and you are reproducing. That's why people were drop out from the educational systems, because they feel that they require a lot of memory. A lot of memory is required. They have to mug up, they have to reproduce so many pages of the education or information. And people, they feel very, very difficult, very difficult. How they would be able to learn 400, 500 pages of the book? When they see the big size of the book, they will feel that, oh, that is not a cup of tea of mine. I cannot continue my education. So basically, we should emphasize on conceptual understanding. And creativity and critical thinking has to be encouraged so that the logical decision making and innovation, which is right now the focus of even MHRD also, they have started with the MHRD Innovation Council, MIC. They have established Institutional Innovation Council at every institution. They have started special ranking on the ranking itself, Atal ranking, ARIIA, Atal ranking on the institutional innovation achievements. Why we are focusing on that? Why suddenly there is a need to focus on creativity and critical thinking? You could see that in this epidemic, you have witnessed a lot of challenging situation, and your critical thinking and your ability to do something new could save our country from this pandemic situation. Then ethics and human and constitutional values, most important thing. Student must have the respect for others. They should have the democratic spirit. They should think about the nation, equality. They should feel that, yes, they should not be giving injustice to anybody other way, right? Focus on the regular formative assessment, not the summative assessment. Like I have told you that if at the end, if suppose the examination is taken up on so complete portion, we are scared of that, no? That such a big portion would be there and we have to give the exam on that, right? So that is very important. Then life skills are very important. You should be able to work in a team, right? And you should cooperate with each other, have the consensus during the working in the team, right? Then definitely extensive use of technology in teaching and learning. Like we are doing it right now. We are using the technology for delivering the knowledge to the students online. There should not be any language barrier. We should promote multilingualism. And language should not be barrier in learning. That should be the focus. Then people should respect for diversity, respect for the local context. You might be teaching them as per the global requirement. I don't disagree with that, but you have a lot of local strength. If it is not taught to the students, they will not be able to use the local natural resources to convert it into the livelihood. That is very important, right? Then basically everybody is focusing on that equity and inclusion, that everybody should be able to get the chance for education. They should not be deprived of that. And most importantly, see, there has to be the synergy. There has to be synergy in curriculum across all levels of education, like in school, colleges, higher educational institutions, research institutions. There has to be synergy in the curriculum. And teachers and faculties are at the heart of the learning process. They are the center of attraction, because their own uniqueness will make the students a well-groomed student. Right? And another focus is light, but tight, right? Regulatory framework. It is, right now also it is there, but to ensure integrity and transparency, right? Integrity and transparency, that is very important. So educational system must be, they should go through this academic audit, then they should have the proper documents being disclosed in public. So public disclosure has to be proper. They should give every information. Then outstanding research has to be the co-partner along with the education, academics. Along with the academics, research has to be also given the importance. And the continuous review of progress, that is very important, the students, the more sought information, whether they have gathered or not. So regular assessment by the educational experts is necessary. Right? So here is this National Education Policy 2020. Right, which is now proposed by this Ministry of Education. Earlier it was Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. And it was approved by the Union Cabinet on 29th July 2020. And it outlines the vision of India's new education system, right? And this policy shall replace the earlier policy of education, which was released in 1986, right? So this policy acts as a framework, guidelines for each type of education, right, from schooling to the higher education or vocational, right? So even the vocational training, and the policy mainly aims to transform India's education system by 2021. But more importantly, at least they aim to transform the Indian education system by 2040. Sufficient time period is given, but the implementation has to start. And hence this NEP has been given in four parts, right? First part deals with school education. Second part is dealing with higher education. Third part is dealing with all other types of education, adult education, vocational education, or something like that. And then the most important fourth part is implementation. Right? So basically, let us see the vision of this national education policy: to instill among the learners deep-rooted pride in being Indian, not only in thought, but also in spirit, in their intellect, and whatever they do. And to develop knowledge, skills, values, so that support and responsible commitment to human rights, sustainable development, right? Definitely, global well-being is also very important. And the student must behave as a global citizen, but at the root, it should have the feeling of Indian, proud feeling of Indian, right? Now, the government has made few clarifications immediately after the release of this policy. Because see, whenever something new will come from the government, people will start analyzing that. And definitely, it cannot satisfy each and everybody's thought process. And hence, they will feel that this will be mandatory part or that will be mandatory part. And they will start feeling that, oh, they have to do like this or like this. So they have made few clarifications just immediately after the release of the policy. Government clarified that no one will be forced to study any particular language, and that the medium of instructions will not be shifted from English to any regional language, because now we have become comfortable with that. Right now, I am also delivering the talk in English. See, I'm saying, like people, they have explained that there is a local language, regional language, national language, global language. It's our thought process. You see, you have to communicate. And when your domain is that of your working, is you are dealing with a lot of people of different background or different languages, you should have the common language which people could understand. That is a thought process. It is not like that somebody feels that this language is not better, that language is not better, but this language should be preferred, or more importantly, people who learn in mother tongue are more importantly, they learn in an easy way. I do agree with that. I don't have absolutely, it's true. And many countries are doing like that. Even you could see that China, Japan, Germany, France, they are, and that's why people are learning their languages to go for the employment in these countries. And a lot of these classes are going on, foreign language classes, right? So basically, languages was the focus here. The policy raises the importance of mother tongue and regional languages, medium of instruction, as basically until class 5 and preferably beyond should be in these languages. But it is not mandatory. See, no language will be imposed on the student. Even though Sanskrit and foreign languages will also be given the emphasis, The policy states that no language will be imposed on the students, right? And they would be evolving language strategy, basically. They would be evolving language strategy, and they should be releasing in this year. They have planned it in NEP 2020, that National Curriculum Framework, which will be released in 2021, they will be giving more strategies on this language, how it is to be taken care, right? So basically, we have to see to it that promotion of mother tongue has to be there, but it's okay. Means you will not be imposing, you will not be forcing, right? Now coming to the first part, that is school education. And since so many years, we are just listening that 10 plus 2, 10 plus 2 means 12 years of education, right? And the most importantly, it covers from age 6 to 18, 12 years of education is now converted into 15 years of education now. 3 years have been added. And the more importantly, early childhood education is the focus in these 3 years. So 5+3+3+4 is the now focus of this new structure, right? You could see this 10 plus 2 replaces by 5+3+3+4. And here you could see that the focus is 3 years of preschool or Anganwadi, which was not the earlier focus. It started from classes 1 to classes 12 in the earlier education policy. And more importantly, they are now focusing on these 3 years of this preschool or Anganwadi, and then 2 years of classes 1 and 2 in the primary school, or like 3 to 8 years, basically. This is the 5 years plan where the education will be the activity-based playful learning. By playing, they will be learning, right? Then preparatory stage, wherein grade 3 to 5, there the focus shall be for developing the reading, speaking, and writing skills, physical education, right? And then from grade 6 to 8, more conceptual depth in the required courses like mathematics, sciences. And then from grade 9, which will be dealt in two groups, 9th and 10th, and 11th and 12th. So basically, they would be focusing on multidisciplinary aspects. Multiple options of subjects will be provided to them so that they could choose where they could perform better. They could choose so that they would do best in their life after that. Otherwise, everybody focuses on science, science, and science. So here they are focusing on early childhood education, early childhood care and education. You could mean they have abbreviated as ECCE, early childhood care and education, which is the foundation of learning. And it is true, and it was even revealed by so many researchers which were carried out in the early childhood education. They said that 85% of the child's brain is developed till the age of 6 years. So most of the learning, if we could provide them up to the 6 years of age, it would be the best part of their life. And hence, it is critically very important. And presently, this early childhood care education is not available to a lot of people. They have mentioned that crores of young children, and especially from socially disadvantaged background. Because see, those who are having money and they are economically strong, they are sending their wards to nursery or pre-nursery or nursery KG1, KG2. They are getting that chance to early childhood care and education, but it is not available to socially and economically and disadvantaged backgrounds. And hence, their main foundation becomes weak. And that is the biggest loss to the nation, That is the biggest loss to the nation, because that brain slowly become a dropout from the education in the upcoming years of their education, right? So that was the focus of these reforms, where early childhood care and education was the more important. Then an urgent and necessary prerequisite is the foundational literacy and numeracy. So that the basic read, write, and perform basic operations with numbers is necessary. It is minimum required. Even you could see that, if you could see that a lot of people who are not having so much good education, but their foundational literacy and numeracy was strong, and they have just completed grade 4 or grade 5, and they are leading so many big business houses. Even they are able to perform good business operations. How that was possible? That was just possible because of their strong foundational literacy and numeracy. But it is not. It was not available from most of the students of disadvantaged groups. So foundational literacy and numeracy an urgent and necessary prerequisite to your learning, and definitely. That will curtail dropout rates and universal access to education at all levels. More importantly, our focus is that we have to curtail dropout rates. That is very important. So one of the primary goals of the schooling system must be to ensure that children are enrolled in and are attending schools. Not only important that they are enrolled in, but they are attending the school. And hence this Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which is now called as Samagra Shiksha, and the Right to Education Act, India was beneficial for this higher enrollment in elementary education. But more challenging part is retaining children in the latter grades of schooling system is a concern. You can see that when if you take 100% initially the enrollment, if you take that figure like 100%, whatever that number would be there, that you don't bother about. But then grade 6 to 8, you could see 90.9. Grades 9 to 10, you could see 79.3. So continuously people are dropping. Right, so dropout rate increases from grade 5 to grade 8 and onward. And hence, it has to be thought of that how this dropout rates could be reduced. That is very important. And more importantly, this curriculum and pedagogy. This curriculum and pedagogy in this 5+3+3+4 system, wherein 5 years of foundation, see, foundation has to be bigger. You could see that in this 5+3+4, which is the bigger component or the more number of years? Foundation, 5 years. Foundation has to be 5 years, and that should be the playful. It should be playful, activity-based. And they learn so much things. Then, the 3 years of preparatory stage, where the discovery, that should be also activity-based only. Then middle stage and secondary stage, 3 years plus 4 years of education. Then in this middle stage, we are focusing on this science, mathematics, or art at the abstract level. And then 9th and 10th, more depth, critical thinking. Right? And then 11th and 12th, wherein they have the ample opportunity to choose the courses. They should have the ample opportunity to choose the courses out of these offered courses of science or arts or humanities or social science. Now teachers, like I have told earlier also, teachers, they shape the future of our children, and hence they are the heart of the education system. And due to this, it is termed as noblest profession. out of the entire, means so many professions available. And more importantly, these teachers, they should be given empowerment. They should be empowered to, like I have told you, to have their thought process in the curriculum, pedagogy, so that they will feel empowered, right? Now, the focus of every education policy, and still we are striving hard to have the equitable and access to all for the education, that is very important, equitable and inclusive education. So single greatest tool for achieving social justice and equity is to have the education for all. That is very important, right? Have the education for all. And this efficient resourcing and effective governance through school complexes and clusters have been proposed, because see, small school sizes have made this, it is not economically viable to have the control and provide that much facility and those kinds of teachers, basically. So hence, it was thought of, it is thought of in the current education policy, that why not to have the resources being made or the governance to be done by clusters, forming the clusters of the schools, like they have proposed the clusters in the higher education also. And even going one step ahead, they have proposed the standard setting and accreditation for school education, right? School education, also they have proposed the accreditation. And basically the regulation must help to empower schools and the teachers with trust. They should not feel like policing, or they should not feel like Inspector Raj or like that. But one has to have the quality controls and measures. Then basically the more important change in this school education system is that examination in not in every year. Examination is not planned every academic year as right now is being there. But they will attend only three exams before board exams. They'll attend only three exams in grade 2, grade 5, and grade 8. And board exams will be continued for classes 10 and 12, but will be redesigned, right? And standard. And the PARAK, which is performance assessment, review, and analysis of knowledge for holistic development, on that basis, the assessment will be there. And these exams would be conducted twice and will be given two attempts, so that people, they don't have the fear of that. There the combination of objective and descriptive, both type of evaluation help there, right? So that is very important. And as I have told that the focus is to reduce the curriculum load of the students and allow them for more experiential learning, more interdisciplinary learning, multilingual exposure, and flexibility. So much flexibility, like if a student wants to pursue fashion studies with physics, it should be possible. If somebody wants to learn bakery with chemistry, that should be also possible. And their report card should not basically give the marks or tell the marks, but it should be holistic type of report cards, like we see the report cards of the CBSE school children. They are writing the skills of the students. See, that is important, basically. After grading, you should see to it that what skills they have acquired is very important. And if you highlight that, and the teacher is the most important element of the education system who can write about the student, because that student was being observed by that teacher over a period of time. Right now, coming to the part two of this this NEP 2020 is higher education, wherein our interest is there, because it plays a very, very extremely important role in the promoting the human and societal well-being. And through this, we are getting our livelihood and economic development of our country, right? And hence, we are focusing on this higher education part. Now, what are the major problems being currently faced by higher education system in India? Fragmented higher educational ecosystem, right? And its less emphasis is given on cognitive skills. There is a rigid separation of disciplines with early specializations, limited access, particularly in socioeconomically disadvantaged areas, right? With few higher education institutions teaching in local languages, limited teacher and institutional autonomy, inadequate mechanisms for merit-based career management and progression of faculty and institutional leaders, lesser emphasis on research at most universities and colleges, and so on and so forth, right? We should not discuss much on that. It doesn't mean that problems were only there in the education system, higher education, no. But these are the few problems which are being thought of, which could be given a complete overhaul, and we can re-energize our higher education system, right? And hence, these drawbacks has to be removed. So it will, these drawbacks will become the, if you make it in a, make that statement in a positive way, you will, that means if it is a single disciplinary education, why not to have a multidisciplinary education? If the rigid system is there, there is less autonomy. If we can give more autonomy to the institution and faculty at large, like that, if we can revamp the curriculum, pedagogy, assessment, and student support, it would enhance the student learning, student experiences, and at large, at the end, nation will grow. And hence, this institutional restructuring and consolidation has been the main thrust of this NEP 2020. It is focusing on, they are saying that the single discipline higher education institution must get converted into multidisciplinary education systems, and that too with enrollment ratio of more than 3,000 plus. That is the thought process. It will take time. By 2030, they feel that educational institution should become multidisciplinary, and by 2040, they feel that they should increase the gross enrollment ratio. See, increasing the enrollment ratio will optimize the resources which is being made available to the institution's students for their learning, so that it becomes economical. Otherwise, it becomes very expensive for many to get that education. Then graded autonomy is another feature of this NEP. And they have proposed the stage-wise mechanism for granting graded economy based on the accreditation. And for accreditation also, they are giving the handholding through either like Paramarsh scheme is there for NAC, which is being proposed by UGC, or Margadarshan scheme is there from the AICT, or like, see, and even if such kind of schemes are available, and there, see, they are properly giving the handholding to the institutions to go ahead with the accreditation process, and with proper accreditation, they shall be given the graded autonomy, and they are planning that autonomous degree granting colleges could evolve into research intensive or teaching intensive universities if they aspire. So if you want to become a very good academic institution only, you can think like from that perspective. If you want to go for research intensive, then you can think from that perspective. Like that, they would have the only two system, either autonomous degree granting college or a constituent college of a university. That is their thought process. And open distance learning is being encouraged. Open for basically increasing the gross enrollment ratio. And these all open distance learning programs and their components shall be of same standard and quality, which are equally available on campuses. That is very important. And hence, top institutions which are accredited for this ODL shall only be given the permission to run those courses, right? And basically, definitely blended is more popular one, and it's more effective one. Blended mode of learning, basically going with the like right now also, now the new approval process of this AICT is encouraging 40% of this online teaching mode in the education system, right? So single stream higher education institutions will be phased out over time. That is their thought process. Single stream higher education institutions will be phased out. That is their thought process. They want that more of the multidisciplinary education, means in the same institution, if somebody is learning engineering, they should be able to get the access to arts, humanities, science, or whatnot, even medical science, so that they can have and work with those teams and they can have the collaborative learning. So higher education institutions to become multidisciplinary. By 2040, the higher education institution shall aim to become multidisciplinary institutions, basically. And by 2030, they want that they should plan to become the multidisciplinary institution, and slowly they should increase the enrollment ratio in their institution, like 3,000 plus. Now, coming to the most important part of the curriculum is holistic and multidisciplinary education. Like earlier, people used to say that 64 kalas. It is not possible right now to have so many knowledge, basically. But earlier, people used to say that. It is not that you just have the, like people, they say that jack of all and master of one instead of master of none. So you should be master of one, but you should have jack of all. So basically, you should have the knowledge of 64 kalas, like singing, painting, scientific fields, vocational like carpentry, clothes making, professional fields like medicine, engineering, communication, soft skills. So many kalas they want that our students should have, like graduate attributes, which have been proposed by National Board of Accreditation, right? 12 graduate attributes, which have now become program outcomes, right? So they have now given multiple exit options in higher education. So means if you start the long journey of 4 years degree program, it doesn't mean that if you complete 1 year and if you go away from that, you are the loser. You don't earn anything except one grade card or mark sheet. But you can see that graduate, undergraduate program will have the multiple exit options. If somebody completes 1 year of study, they will get certificate. If 2 years of study, they will get diploma. And if 3 years of bachelor's, they will get bachelor's degree. And 4 year multidisciplinary bachelor's degree. You can prefer one specialization and you can get them 4 year multidisciplinary bachelor's degree with research component, and that will help to you to go for directly go for PhD. That is the beauty of this thought process, right? And then flexibility, flexible master's program and PhD program after 4 years of bachelor's degree. Higher education institutions will have the flexibility, basically, to offer these different master programs. There may be 2 year program with the second year devoted entirely on research for those who completed only 3 year bachelor's program. But for students completing 4 years bachelor's program with research, there could be only 1 year master's program, or there could be only integrated 5 years bachelor's and master's program, or undertaking PhD may require only master's degree or a bachelor's degree, 4 years bachelor's degree with research. And they are discontinuing with MPhil program, right? So multidisciplinary approach is very, very important, and they are planning to establish model public universities for holistic and multidisciplinary education. They would be termed as MERUs, and they would be at par with IITs and IIMs. MERUs would be multidisciplinary education and research universities, right? And they will help to set the highest standards of multidisciplinary education, which has been thought of and which is the current focus of the NEP 2020. And basically, they are even advocating optimal learning environments and support for students. See, for any effective learning, four important components are there. You should have appropriate curriculum, right? You should have the pedagogy, which will keep students engaging. You should have the continuous and formative assessment instead of summative assessment. And you should have the adequate facilities for student support so that their health, psychological well-being is maintained along with the knowledge when they are getting it. So, ideal curriculum, engaging pedagogy, continuous formative assessment along with the support for the overall development of the student is the focus of this optimal learning environments and support for students. Then another focus is on internationalization. See, internationalization means not that we could not be aloof from the foreign education system. So they are focusing on having a large number of international students studying in India and even providing mobility to the students in India who may wish to visit and study abroad or want the credit transfer like that. So internationally relevant curricula has to be there in sciences, social sciences and beyond, and they should give the meaningful opportunities. That is very important, meaningful opportunities for social engagement, right? Then student activity and participation is the another focus. Everything has to be given the particularly the importance. Since students are your prime stakeholders in the education system, and hence campus life has to be vibrant. Today, our students, since last 15 months, they are not able to enjoy their campus life. They are at home, and from home they are learning. They are losing many things which they could get at the campus life. Lot of opportunities for sports, cultural, arts, club, even though we are trying to have online, but it will not serve the purpose. It will not serve the purpose. Then financial support for the students, even though continuously government is taking care that they are coming up with some or the other schemes to provide the financial support to the socially and disadvantaged groups so that nobody should be deprived from getting the quality higher education. That is very important, right? Private higher education institutions will be encouraged to offer larger number of free seats and scholarship to their students, right? So that is another part, means financial support has to be there. Otherwise, you will not be able to give increase the gross enrollment ratio. You should have motivated, energized, and capable faculty. Because the heart and soul of educational system, again and again, we are focusing that we teachers are. Teachers who are attending this lecture, you should see to it that the AICTE is also coming up with many, many schemes to develop the faculties. This is also one of the faculty development programs offered in association with IST. Even ATAL is offering, even AICT alone is also offering. So many ways, even UGC, everybody is offering the opportunities for faculty development. So motivated, energized, and capable faculty is the heart and soul of education system, and they should be given empowerment to conduct innovative teaching, and they should be empowered to design their own pedagogy. That is very important with the mechanism of control for accountability. Again, the focus is on equity and inclusion in higher education, like was in school education, so that each and every community which is socially and economically disadvantaged should not be deprived of this higher education. That is very important. Now coming to the most important part of discussion, they are planning to have the Higher Education Council of India. And they would club basically the three regulatory bodies. I'll be discussing this at the latter stage in slightly detailed manner. So they are focusing on having National Higher Education Regulatory Council, NHERC, which will regulate all higher education, excluding only medical and legal. Then National Accreditation Council, that will be META accrediting body, NAC. Then Higher Education Grants Council, which will take care of all funding and grant support to the education. Then General Education Council, which will focus on graduate attributes, learning outcomes. Their work shall be to groom and propose the graduate attributes or the learning outcomes which are expected, and even framing National Higher Education Qualification Framework, NHEQF, or National Council for Teachers Education, NCTE, which is a professional standard setting body, right? Under this general education. Now, professional standard setting body may have the professional councils from like Veterinary Council of India, Council of Architecture, Indian Council of Agricultural Research, National Council for Vocational Education. They would come under this professional standard setting body, one PSSB. And National Testing Agency shall be given the work of conducting examination to give the admissions. Apart from this JEE Mains or NEET, they shall be conducting the examination to give the admissions in universities across the country, right? So, and internationalized education in India, foreign universities can now set up campuses in India, and fees of both private and public universities will be fixed. Right now also it is being done. Now, again, the focus is on the teacher education. So to become a teacher, a 4-year bachelor of education will be minimum requirement needed by 2030. Recruitment process will also be strengthened and made transparent. And NCTE will frame a national curriculum framework for teacher education by 2021 and a national professional standard for teachers by 2022, right? So that is very important that NEP is focusing on that. Now, they are also focusing on vocational education. You could see that BVOC is being now becoming popular in many higher education institutions, and most of the institutions have started BVocational courses, BVOC, right? Because in our country, that enrollment ratio is very less, and we were just focusing on the dropout people, but that should not be the focus of that. You can see that USA, it is 52%, Germany 75%, South Korea 96%, and here it's only 5%. So we have to see to it that we should focus on this vocational education, which is a part of now NEP 2020. Now, basically, NEP is for catalyzing quality academic research in all fields through a new National Research Foundation, NRF. And you could see that the investment in terms of GDP is 0.69% of GDP in India, basically on research and innovation, as compared to 2.8% in USA, or 4.3% in Israel, or 4.2% in South Korea. So National Research Foundation will take care of that, and it will catalyze. It will increase with the speed the research in the higher education institutions. Now, transforming the regulatory system of higher education system, that is very important. Like four verticals are being proposed. You can see four verticals, Higher Education Commission of India, four verticals are being proposed. Right? Now, the first vertical, if you see, if you can see, the first vertical is the National Higher Education Regulatory Council, NHERC. Except this medical and legal, like I have said earlier also, it would be the single point regulator for higher education and teacher education, right? Then second vertical is accreditation. Basically, like we have so many accrediting bodies, but instead of that, there will be meta accrediting body, National Accreditation Council, NAC. Then you have the third vertical as Higher Education Grants Council to take care of these funding supports and grants to the higher education institutions. And the fourth vertical is General Education Council to frame learning outcomes or graduate attributes. The most important is this, where our students, people, they say that they lack in this competency, skills, or the knowledge and the attitude. So all should be amalgamated to have the proper learning outcomes. That is very important. And this professional councils will come under these professional standard setting bodies, like we discussed this, like VCI or NCT, ICAR or COA, that is architecture, or like that. And they will play a role in the higher education system, and they would be the invited members of this General Education Council, because they would know the learning outcomes of the different streams, like what is needed in agriculture research, what is needed in architecture, what is needed in this teacher education, or likewise, right? So they would be the invited members of this General Education Council for framing this basically the curriculum and the learning outcomes, right? Now, this functioning of this autonomous body, basically, you can see that the functioning of these independent verticals for regulation, like NHERCC, that is regulation, this NAC for accreditation, or higher education grants commission for funding, or General Education Council for academic standard setting, you can see. And they would have the autonomous behavior, but they would work on the principle of faceless and transparent regulatory system. See, right now you were feeling that they would come to the institution, they would visit, they would capture the photograph and the video of all the facilities and that. Instead of that, they want to go for faceless type of accreditation system, faceless type of regulation system, but with the use of technology, that is possible. That is possible, right? Then curbing commercialization of education. Even though the private education system is the biggest strata, but this would basically have the multiple mechanisms with checks and balances to stop the commercialization of higher education. It doesn't mean that, means basically you should see to it that when we go for this imparting education, we say that it is for not for profit. So whatever is generated, it should be reinvested in the education sector for their development, for their enrichment of that educational system, educational environment, right? So that is the another focus of that. Then effective governance and leadership for higher education system. Right now, due to smaller institutions, they are not getting that ample opportunity of effective governance and leadership. But with the forming the clusters, graded accreditation, graded autonomy, and this way they could give the effective governance and leadership in the educational institutions so that they become world-class institutions. And in a phased-wise manner, they have planned that in another 15 years of time, all higher education institutions in India will aim to become independent, self-governing institutions, which will pursue innovation and excellence. That is the most important element of this NEP 2020. So basically, they are trying to give the more autonomy to the institution, but on a graded accreditation system. They want to ensure also before giving autonomy that whether or not they would be able to take up, whether they will be able to take up this responsibility and give that sort of quality in education, or they would be able to maintain that quality education. So that's why they have clubbed with this graded accreditation, the graded autonomy. Then the part three is focusing on other key areas wherein professional education is one of the most important area. Like we say that these are the professional degree, So preparation of professional should have education in the ethics and importance of public purpose. That is very important. Apart from the education in the discipline, so it must centrally involve the critical and interdisciplinary thinking, and that is very important. Right, professional education should become the integral part of overall higher education system, and it must be adopted by all these universities, either legal universities, technical universities, agricultural universities, health science universities, or standalone institutions in all the other fields. Professional, because they perform and they are giving the services, and hence professional education is very, very important part of the higher education system, but they are being taken care separately in the NEP. Then adult education and lifelong learning, because opportunity to attain foundational literacy and numeracy was there, and that would help every citizen to pursue their livelihood, to earn their livelihood. That is very important. And Most importantly, if you can see that per capita GDP of any country is proportional to literacy rates, you cannot afford, any nation cannot afford to have a non-literate member. Non-literate member means it is a total loss of the nation. We don't say that everybody should become either engineer, doctor, or something like that. But they should get the foundational literacy and numeracy. That is very, very important part of any country. Foremost goal of any country. So adult education and lifelong learning is very important. Then another is promotion of Indian languages, art, and culture. Since India has a lot of languages, culture, and people from so many countries used to come here and learn, and hence, due to this culture and natural wealth, which we are not exploring much, but people from other parts of countries, they are coming and they are exploring, and hence, we should see to it that this really, the wordings like incredible India should be achieved, basically. Right, so that is the highest priority, promotion of Indian languages, arts, and culture. Along with that, now technology use and integration is very important, because India is global leader in information and communication technology and in other cutting edge domains. So Digital India campaign is really helping to transform the entire nation into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy. Even though we have faced a lot of difficulties in the initial implementation part, but now slowly it has gained that momentum, and people are using it, and they are now taking it in a positive way, right? So use and integration of this technology to improve multiple aspects of education will be supported and adopted, right? And an autonomous body, they are forming National Educational Technology Forum, so that this technology use in the education, right now also we are doing through Swayam and PL or virtual labs or Diksha, or so many platforms are there through which this we are going for this online education. Right, so digital media is being used. So government is planning to form the autonomous body, National Educational Technology Forum, which will be created to provide a platform for the free exchange of ideas and the use of technology, right, to enhance learning, assessment, planning, administration, and so on, both for school and higher education. Right, now online and digital, see, online and digital education is also very important, and it will reduce the expense, basically, and definitely it will ensure, due to this, it will ensure equitable use of this technology also. And looking towards this, the pandemic situation, right? We have definitely adopted alternative modes of education, right? And we are extensively now using ICT. Earlier, we were not knowing also different platforms, different softwares like we have now Zoom or WebEx or GoTo or GoMeeting or Google Meet or Microsoft Teams. So many platforms are coming up. See, these digital platforms were not earlier known. They might be available and they were only used for some limited purpose. But now, this digital is very, very important that it has now come and extensively used by education system. And due to this, government is planning to conduct pilot studies for online education. And pilot studies will be conducted by this either national this educational technology forum which will be formed, and these IITs, NITs, or these prominent government bodies, they would be conducting the pilot studies on the benefits and the disadvantages of this, and so that how they could be used for this imparting the education and even the online assessment. And that is very important. Then due to this, we have to focus on digital infrastructure, right? And there is a need to invest in creation of open public digital infrastructure in the education sector, which can be used by multiple platforms, because each education institution cannot invest so much, and hence we have to see to it that such platforms are available to those institutions also. So online teaching platform and tools were made available by government, and they are being extensively used by education system, right? Swayam, like I have said, and even Diksha, and tools like two-way video or two-way audio interface for holding online classes, right? In the present academic also, pandemic and epidemic, we are using it, right? Then content. See, a lot of digital content is being made. So content creation, digital repository, and dissemination has made it. You are able to see that a lot of apps are being made. The learning apps are being made, and they are fun-based learning apps. So that with fun you are learning, and hence they are becoming more popular. And now people are eager to learn through those virtual platforms. Then addressing this digital divide, because there is a fact that a substantial section of the population doesn't have the digital access, even though we feel that, but many people, they don't have access to the mobile or the internet connectivity or like that. And hence this digital divide basically amongst this population is also a very important problem which should be addressed. Because of this unavailability of those facilities, many people are not able to get that education through online system. Then virtual labs are already popularly used by many existing higher education institutions. So that will be strengthened, and it would be made more user friendly. Or through this, now digital ways are there to give the access of the even screens to those students. You are able to make them feel that they are operating those systems. Then with online teaching, you have to focus on online assessment and online examinations, and hence appropriate bodies like PARAK, school boards, or national teaching agencies, or other bodies will take care, and they would be given the responsibility. Because now you cannot move back. If you have started online education system, it doesn't mean that you will move back once the pandemic is over. but you have to use it in a blended mode. You have to use it in a blended mode, and hence blended MOOCs or blended models of learning will become popular in near future. In near future, blended mode of learning will become more popular because there is an importance of face-to-face on in-person learning. But you cannot now avoid online education system. So you will have the proper blending of this online mode of learning and face-to-face learning. So that will necessitate, right, to create a dedicated unit for building of world-class digital infrastructure for this educational digital content and capacity. Because, and see, people from the with good economic conditions, they would be able to do so, but government is focusing on that everybody should get the access so that this digital infrastructure should be available. That is very important. Now, the other important changes in this NEP, you can see that National Education Commission is being formed, headed by Honorable Prime Minister of India. Then Academic Bank of Credit. See, you have a bank wherein you deposit your money and your money is safe and you can know the how many rupees are there. So similarly, you will have the academic bank and where your credits will be deposited and where credits will be available. National Research Foundation, NRF. NRF is there to improve research. And then special education zones would be formed to focus on the education of underrepresented group, right? Then gender inclusion fund would be separately to deal with education of female and transgender children. And the NETF, National Educational Technology Forum, to facilitate exchange of ideas on technology usage to improve learning, right? So these are the bodies, this policy proposes. Another important change is the policy proposes new language institutions. See, at every point of time, some or the other creations of the institutions were there, and you could see that from you had IITs only, then regional institutions were converted into NITs, then you had IIITs, then you have ISERS, then you have other space institutions also, even mathematics institutions. And likewise, here now they are proposing the Indian Institute of Translation and Interpretation. So that is very important. See, that will improve your language growth. Now the last part, in just another 2 minutes, I will conclude. Last part is making it happen. Implementation part, right? Because the policy has been made, major reforms have been given, people are even accepting also. And hence, the most important and challenging task is making it happen. So implementation is basically, will be first implementation is implementation of the spirit and intent of the policy will be the most critical factor. Because first of all, you should accept these reforms in total spirit. Then second is to important to implement policy initiatives in phase-wise manner. You cannot have the sudden changes. You have to give time, sufficient time to go through, because so many changes are being there. The system which is in place since last more than 3 decades, you need to change it in a phase-wise manner. And hence, even government has also given the time duration and phases. And first is to make it more aware of the facilities which are available. Third is prioritizing, because a lot of points are there. You have to prioritize which should be taken up first, which should be taken up next, and like that. You have to prioritize what should be implemented first. Then fourth is comprehensiveness in implementation. because it is interconnected. All the decisions are interconnected, policies interconnected and holistic in nature. Then fifth step is education. Since education is a concurrent subject, it will need careful planning, joint monitoring and collaborative implementation. Because central team has proposed, central government has proposed, so many states have their own way to implement. They have to have the synergy in between. Then sixth implementation step would be infusion of the resources which will be needed. Lot of resources would be needed, either in the form of human, infrastructural, financial, because that is also important. Unless and until you infuse that resources, and finally you should have the careful analysis and review of the linkages between the multiple parallel implementation steps which are being proposed by NEP 2020. Right? So thank you so much for your patient listening, and thank you so much the organizing team of this IPS technology and management Gwalior for giving me the opportunity to share my views on NEP 2020. Thank you so much. Over to you.